The Mysterious Old Radio Listening Society Podcast.
Welcome to the Mysterious Old Radio Listening Society, a podcast dedicated to suspense, crime, and horror stories from the golden age of radio. I'm Eric.
I'm Tim.
And I'm Joshua.
We love mysterious old-time radio stories, but do they stand the test of time? That's what we're here to find out.
It is our 250th episode. And we are celebrating this milestone with the Adventures of Sherlock Holmes and its star-studded adaptation of one of the most iconic detective stories ever written, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's The Final Problem.
Published as The Adventure of the Final Problem, the story first appeared in the Strand magazine in December of 1893. Doyle had intended to make the story his final work featuring Holmes, but pressure from fans convinced the author to revisit the great detective later. The story introduced Holmes' diabolical nemesis, Professor James Moriarty. Although Moriarty is mentioned in several other later stories, he only appeared once more in The Valley of Fear, a story set before the events of The Final Problem.
Confusingly, this series, The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, was produced after The New Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, which had featured Basil Rathbone and Nigel Bruce for much of its 11-year run from 1939 to 1950. Prior to New Adventures, an earlier radio series simply called Sherlock Holmes ran from 1930 to 1936. This run began on NBC with Richard Gordon in the title role and eventually moved to the Blue Network with Louise Hector taking over as Holmes. Hector would go on to play the role of Moriarty opposite Basil Rathbone in the New Adventures of Sherlock Holmes.
The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes was produced by the BBC in 1953 and featured John Gielgud as Holmes and Ralph Richardson as Watson. Gielgud's fame had been temporarily derailed by a personal scandal. For a time, he avoided stage and screen roles to focus on directing and on radio. The show's producer, Harry Allen Towers, was happy to have the remarkable actor star in a show. Towers had previously been successful distributing transcribed British radio productions to independent stations in the United States, and The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes followed suit. In 1954, the series was broadcast on WCRA. Val Gielgud, John's brother, directed, and when the time came, played the role of Sherlock's brother, Mycroft. For the role of Moriarty, however, the series cast the one and only Orson Welles. And now, let's listen to Gielgud's Holmes face off against the evil genius of Welles Moriarty in The Final Problem. First broadcast December 21st, 1954.
It's late at night, and a chill has set in. You're alone, and the only light you see is coming from an antique radio. Listen to the sounds coming from the speaker, listen to the music, and listen to the voices.
The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes. We present the original stories of the late Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, dramatized anew with Sir John Gielgud as Sherlock Holmes, Sir Ralph Richardson as Dr. Watson, and today, Orson Welles as Professor Moriarty.
It is with a heavy heart that I come before you with the last adventure of my friend Sherlock Holmes that I shall be able to relate. I have tried in my humble way to chronicle some of our exploits together, to demonstrate the singular gifts of that most remarkable of men. It lies with me now to tell you what occurred between Holmes and his arch enemy, Professor Moriarty, when at last they came face to face.
Mr. Sherlock Holmes, Your efforts on the side of law and order have seriously inconvenienced me. The situation between us is becoming an impossible one, Mr. Holmes. It simply cannot go on. One or the other of us must die. Must die, Mr. Holmes.
It was in the spring of 1891. You will remember, perhaps, that after my marriage and return to private practice, Holmes and I had drifted apart a little. I followed the newspaper reports of his cases, of course, and called on him quite often at the old rooms in Baker Street. Even so, however, many weeks would sometimes elapse between our meetings. And so it was with some surprise, one April evening, that I looked up and saw him standing before me in my study.
Good evening, Watson.
Oh, good evening, Holmes.
Have you a cigarette for me?
Holmes, great heavens, man, how ill you look.
Oh, I dare say I've been using myself up rather too freely of late, old friend. You've no objection if I close your window shutters?
No, of course not. You're not afraid of anything, are you?
Well, to tell you the truth, I am, rather.
Well, it's not like you, Holmes. What is it?
Air guns.
Air guns? What on earth do you mean?
There's a new and deadly type of air gun, Watson, which has been specially designed by an old acquaintance of ours.
Who? What, Professor Moriarty? It can only be he from your tone.
The same. A match. Give me a match, will you, my dear fellow?
Yes, of course.
Oh, thank you. Is Mrs. Watson at home?
Oh, no, she's on a visit to an aunt.
Oh, good.
Quite alone.
Good, good. That makes it easier for me to propose that you should come away with me for a few days.
Oh, delighted. But where?
Oh, the continent. Somewhere abroad.
Huh? Abroad?
Yeah, is that whiskey in the decanter there?
Yes. Now, look here, Holmes. What's all this about? There's something more serious in your manner than...
You never did quite believe in the iniquities of Moriarty, did you, Watson? You've said so more than once.
I felt you exaggerated a bit. After all, Professor Moriarty is a respectable figure in public life.
Just so, and that's the very genius of the man. Even you, Watson, knowing me as you do, can't quite believe me when I tell you that he corrupts all London with his evil influence.
Oh, I can't quite believe that.
Oh, of course, to the world he's still the professor, the great mathematician. He's respectable.
But what real proof have you that he's anything else?
None.
Well?
At least... not until this last month. And even now the chain isn't quite complete. But 3 days more, and I shall have him, Watson. 3 days more, if I live to see them.
You can't seriously suppose that your life's in danger, Holmes?
No.
Oh, you always love to be melodramatic.
Melodramatic? Listen, Watson, this very morning, in those old rooms of ours in Baker Street, I saw him face to face. I spoke to him.
Moriarty?
Your distinguished professor. Within him a criminal strain of the most diabolical kind. That great white dome of a forehead, those hooded eyes, and the white face pushed forward, oscillating from side to side like a snake's.
Well, of course, if you believe the old heresy of physiognomy...
It isn't only that, of course not. I've worked for years to follow 1,000 different threads, and every one of them has led to Moriarty. He's the Napoleon of crime, Watson, the secret organizer of almost everything evil that goes undetected in this great city of ours. There he sits, motionless like a spider in the center of its web, a web with 1,000 strands, and he controls them, every one. But slowly, very slowly, my own secret plans to expose him have borne fruit. Every day my net is drawing tighter, and he knows it, Watson. He knows the danger he's in, and that was why today he came to see me. I was playing my violin, as you know I often do when I want to think, and suddenly there he was, standing in the doorway, with his white face swaying in that evil way, peering at me with his hooded eyes.
Good morning.
Professor Moriarty, good morning to you.
Mr. Sherlock Holmes, I believe. How very charmingly you play.
How kind of you to say so. Won't you be seated, Professor Moriarty? I can spare you just 5 minutes.
Singularly good of you, thank you. I will sit down. May I say something personal, Mr. Holmes?
Certainly.
Well,
surprised to discover that you have rather less cranial development than one might have expected.
Whereas you, on the contrary, have rather more than I had imagined, Professor. You will recollect, I am sure, however, that Beethoven's outdid us both. However, our personal characteristics are hardly relevant to the present situation. What have you really got to say to me?
Well, perhaps I only suggested, of course, perhaps it is a dangerous habit to finger loaded firearms in the pocket of one's dressing gown, Mr. Holmes.
Evidently you share that dangerous habit, Professor. I see that you keep your hand in the pocket of your morning coat. Supposing we lay our pistols and our cards on the table.
By all means. I was about to suggest it myself. Ah, I see you favor the Mauser type, Mr. Holmes, and without a silencer. You must permit me to present you sometime with one of these small devices of my own design. They're quite convenient in avoiding unpleasant noise, you know.
How very kind of you, Professor. You must ask the hangman to deliver it to me as your last request.
You evidently don't know me, Mr. Holmes.
On the contrary, I think I know you better than you know yourself. I wouldn't take up your gun again, Professor. I've already got you covered with mine.
So I perceive, but I assure you it was only to give a harmless demonstration.
Of the silencer?
Of my own small accomplishments as a marksman, Mr. Holmes. I've read in those accounts of Dr. Watson, that somewhat bovine, but...
I beg your pardon?
No doubt amiable friend of yours, that those marks on the wall there are made from your indoor revolver practice.
Quite so. The initials there, V.R., Victoria Regina, God Save Her Majesty.
Now that I see them, it seems perhaps that they're not quite as symmetrical as they might be. One side of the V is a little short, I think. Permit me to correct the slip.
Admirable, Professor Moriarty. You were perfectly right, of course. That little mistake has now been rectified. I would like, however, if I may, to improve upon it. Your bullet mark is perhaps a shade smaller than my own. Permit me...
Admirable, Mr. Holmes.
Yes, precisely. Above your own mark, Professor. The exact spot, I think. No, no, pray don't look alarmed. My good landlady is quite accustomed to that noise. We shall not be disturbed.
I'm very glad of it, for what I have to say is not without importance, Mr. Holmes. Shall we stop our fencing and begin?
By all means, if you will permit me first to correct one statement that you made just now.
Well, sir?
With reference to my friend Dr. Watson. I'm afraid I can hardly permit the adjective bovine.
Oh.
In his accounts of my humble exploits, he's been good enough to exaggerate my own achievements and has always been unduly modest about his own. He is a most upright and honorable gentleman, Professor, and very close to my heart. You may say what you will about me, but I can allow no derogatory words about him.
Very well, Mr. Holmes. I apologize. We who are about to die salute him. At least you do.
You're very certain, aren't you, Professor Moriarty, that it is I who am going to die?
There is no other course, unless you listen to reason. The situation between us, Mr. Holmes, is becoming an impossible one. It simply cannot go on.
It won't, I assure you. For these past few months, I've been working to put an end to it all at the earliest possible moment.
And you have very nearly undone the careful endeavor of a lifetime, sir. Or at least have seriously threatened it. No, 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 don't move. Your pistol again. I'm only taking out my memorandum book.
Oh, I beg your pardon.
I find it recorded here that you crossed my path on the 4th of January, Holmes. On the 23rd, you incommoded me. By the middle of February, I was seriously inconvenienced by you. At the end of March, I was absolutely hampered. And now, at the close of April, I find myself placed in such a position, through your continual persecution, that I'm in positive danger of losing my liberty.
That was certainly the end I had in view.
Then you must drop it, Mr. Holmes. You really must, you know.
Not till after Monday, Professor. You know as well as I do that you've made a slip. One single tiny slip. For years I've been aware of you, Moriarty, at the center of your organization. Forgeries, murder cases, robberies. 1,000 crimes were planned by you. 100 agents carried them out. Your subordinates were caught sometimes, but you never were. And yet, you know, you made that slip. That single tiny slip. And you know as well as I do that it will destroy you. In 3 more days, my evidence will be complete. I shall have you exposed, brought to trial, condemned, and hanged. And you can do nothing whatever to prevent it. My will is inflexible.
And so is mine. 3 days, do you say? And before they're out, the end will come. One or the other of us must die, sir.
Quite so. The 5 minutes is up, Professor, and I must really ask you to excuse me. In the pleasure of our conversation, I'm afraid that I've neglected business of importance elsewhere.
Very well, then. It's seems a pity, Mr. Holmes, that I've done what I could. I admit that it's been an intellectual pleasure for me to see the way in which you grappled with this affair, but I tell you solemnly, Sherlock Holmes, that if you are clever enough to bring destruction on me, you may rest assured that I shall do as much to you.
You have paid me several compliments during this interview, Professor. Let me pay you one in return when I say that if I were assured of the former eventuality, I would most cheerfully accept the latter.
I can promise you the one, but not the other. Good day, Mr. Holmes.
Oh, your pistol, Professor. You may need it before Monday.
Thank you.
Good day, Professor.
I think goodbye is the word, Mr. Sherlock Holmes. Goodbye.
So it was, you see, Watson, that singular interview with the greatest criminal of all time.
And his with the greatest detective.
Oh, thank you, my dear fellow.
But what are you going to do, Holmes?
I told you, we leave for the continent. Moriarty's not the man to let the grass grow under his feet. Already one or two accidents have nearly befallen me today.
Upon my soul.
Yes. The police are gathering all my evidence against him. Everything will be complete in 3 short days. Meanwhile, I can only lie low. Are you able to leave your practice to come with me?
Well, I have an accommodating neighbor.
Ah, dear Watson, I knew I could count on you. All right, then. Now, these are your instructions. Listen most carefully.
Instructions, Holmes?
I assure you they are most necessary. Tomorrow morning at 8:45, you will take a hansom cab.
I'll arrange for one to call.
No, you really must obey me to the letter, Watson. You'll leave the house alone tomorrow morning and take neither the first nor the second cab which presents itself at the rank.
Very well, Holmes.
Hand the address to the cabman written on a slip of paper and tell him not to throw it away.
And I drive, I take it, to Victoria Station.
On the contrary, you drive to the Strand end of the Lowther Arcade.
I see. And then?
Have your fare ready, and the instant your cab stops, pay him and dash through the arcade, timing yourself to reach the other side at exactly 9:15.
Yes, but my dear
now
Holmes...
Now listen, man. Listen carefully. It's vital. Our lives depend upon it. When you get there, you'll find a brougham standing close to the curb, driven by a fellow with a black cloak tipped with red. Say nothing. Simply jump in, and he'll drive you to Victoria in time for the Continental Express.
And where shall I meet you, Holmes?
The second coach from the front of the train, a first-class carriage reserved for us. Good night, Watson. And as you value our lives, don't forget a single word of my instructions.
No, of course not, Holmes.
Until we meet tomorrow, then.
Until we meet. I was infected myself with something of his own inner excitement and sense of menace. I took the hansom and then the brougham with its massive hooded driver. I said nothing to him, as I was instructed, and he never spoke to me. A moment later, we were rattling to the station. There he left me and drove off without a further glance, his face still hidden. There was no sign of Holmes, and my heart sank miserably. I found our reserved carriage, but through some confusion, a decrepit old Italian priest was sitting there. The moment came for departure. Still, I waited by the window in a chill of fear.
Scusa, signor. Pray go.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Padre. I don't speak Italian.
Nor do I, Watson.
Good heavens, Holmes.
No, quiet, man. This is no laughing matter. Not yet, anyway.
There, let's look.
You see?
Stop the train!
It's Moriarty himself.
The tall man? He'll never do it.
Stop the train, I say! Let me go, you fool! All you only knew! Let me go!
Even the great Moriarty himself is helpless against the British railway system, Watson. Well, it gives us an hour's respite, at least.
But how did he know where we were?
By watching you, I expect.
But I did everything you told me. Wait, Holmes. The driver of the brougham.
Well, what about him?
He was muffled. I didn't see his face. It must have been one of Moriarty's men.
My dear Watson, it was nothing of the sort. It was my brother Mycroft, shaken for once out of his armchair at the Diogenes Club.
Good heavens. The thing is serious, then?
Of course. But at least we have an hour, and I can use it to take off this disguise and think things over.
But we've escaped him altogether, surely, since the train connects with the boat.
My dear fellow, you evidently don't realize even now that Moriarty is an opponent on practically the same intellectual plane as myself. Do you really imagine that if I were the pursuer, I would permit myself to be baffled by so slight an obstacle as an express train?
What'll he do, then?
What I should do, engage a special.
But it'd be too late, even then.
By no means. We stop at Canterbury, don't forget. And then there's always a delay of a quarter of an hour when the train gets to Dover.
Oh, so you'd almost think we were the criminals to be chased like this? You mean that he'll catch us after all, then?
I hope not. We shan't be there, Watson.
Look here, Holmes. I hate to grumble after all this time, but really, I do think you ought to tell me what you mean.
Heaven bless you for a stout and faithful friend, Watson. I'm sorry. It's only that...
Well,
I don't want to expose you to danger, too. That's why I'm being so mysterious. It's very simple, really. We shall just get out at Canterbury.
Indeed. And not go on the continent after all, I suppose.
Oh, yes, we must do that. We've no choice but to hide away until after Monday, when the evidence will have been completed. You've not seen the papers this morning, I suppose.
Oh, really, Holmes? What time do you think I've had for that?
One must try to make time for everything, Watson. You really should have read about Baker Street.
Hmm? What, Baker Street?
Yes, they set fire to our rooms last night. Mrs. Hudson was away from home, fortunately, and no one was hurt, I'm glad to say. They thought I was there, of course.
Oh, my soul, the thing's intolerable, Holmes.
Yes, only till Monday, Watson, and by then we'll be in Switzerland. We'll make a cross-country journey from Canterbury and take the other boat from New Haven to Dieppe. Unless, of course...
What?
Our friend the professor deduces what I would deduce and gets off at Canterbury himself. Ah, that would truly be a coup de maître.
He surely never would.
Well, I rather doubt it. There are limits even to his intelligence. No, I think we are safe enough, old friend. And now there's time for a pipe, I fancy. Won't you join me, Watson?
And thus it befell. As we hid behind a pile of luggage at Canterbury, we saw the single carriage of the special go thundering past us. And so we made our way across country and at last reached Switzerland. It seemed we had eluded him. To fill in every detail of the final scene is hardly possible, since there was no witness to it. Yet, from a certain source that I cannot yet divulge, I do know something of that last encounter. We wandered at our will through the lovely valley of the Rhone and made our way by way of Interlaken to the little township of Mirrigan among the Alps. The fatal Monday came and went, and yet I was still aware of a strange, febrile excitement in my companion. He was at times feverishly on the alert, then sinking into reverie, and would smile strangely to himself. I went with him, on that last day of all, on a visit to the falls of Reichenbach, forever hallowed and yet cursed in my memory. It's a fearful place indeed, with a torrent plunging far below into a tremendous abyss, a chasm lined by coal-black glistening rock. High above, a pathway's been cut in the cliff face to afford a better view, but it ends abruptly in mid-air, and the traveller has to return as he came. We stood there, giddily marvelling at the great spectacle, and on the instant came a message for me by a village lad to say that an English lady back at the hotel was seriously ill and needed my immediate attention. I turned to go. I looked back, and I saw Holmes leaning against a rock, with his arms folded, gazing down at the rush of the waters. It was the last I saw.
Is that you, Watson? Back already? Well, Moriarty.
Well, Sherlock Holmes. You see, I found you after all. And alone.
Alone, as indeed you must be too. Now that your confederates are all under lock and key, I've heard from Scotland Yard.
I escaped. I was too clever for them, Holmes.
I don't doubt it. But I'm afraid your occupation's gone, Professor, with your organization destroyed. unless you care to return to your mathematics.
It was not my intention. I have another and more immediate intention, Sherlock Holmes. Are you prepared?
Well, before we discuss that, perhaps you'll extend me one small courtesy, Professor.
Most certainly. What is it?
My friend Watson, Professor. No doubt he will be somewhat concerned. May I just take a moment to scribble a note to him?
Certainly. We can fix the paper beneath my alpenstock there, so that it does not blow away. Pray take as long as you wish.
That's very good of you. Please, don't stop talking, Professor. I mastered long ago the art of writing and conversing at the same time.
Thank you. You know, of course, that the message which arrived for Dr. Watson was a false one.
Oh, yes, of course. I knew it at once. And that it could only come from one source.
And yet you let him go?
Yes, Professor, I let him go. I am not without some affection for him. I did not wish to put his life in danger, too. Besides? I've looked forward for a long time to this final duel between us.
I believe it, Holmes. You're a very remarkable man. In many ways. Many, many ways, sir. I'm proud to have known you.
Oh, and are you, Professor? There, my letter's done, then. Perhaps you'll be kind enough to place it, as you suggested.
Right.
Now, how shall it be, Moriarty?
I did not bring a pistol, Holmes.
Thank you. Your courtesy puts me to shame, Professor. Here is my pistol. It goes into the falls.
Hand to hand?
Yes. Goodbye, Professor Moriarty.
Goodbye, Sherlock Holmes.
When I returned to that broken pathway, it was only too clear what had happened. It needed no great application of Holmes' own methods of deduction. Two sets of footsteps to the verge, and none returning. Locked in each other's arms as they fought, they had gone down to the abyss. Only the letter, the last greeting from my friend and comrade. "My dear, dear Watson," he wrote.
"My dear, dear Watson, I scribble this through the courtesy of Professor Moriarty, who awaits my convenience for the final discussion of those eternal questions which lie before us. There can be but one outcome, although I fear that it is at a cost which will give pain to my friends, and especially, my dear Watson, to you. I think, however, that I may go so far as to say that I have not lived entirely in vain. Pray tell Inspector Patterson that the papers which he needs for a full conviction of the Moriarty gang are in pigeonhole M. Before leaving England, I made every disposition of my property and handed it over to my brother Mycroft. Pray give my affectionate greetings to Mrs. Watson and remember me as I used to be in our old days at Baker Street, pacing to and fro with my violin and driving you to a point of sad distraction with that theme you still were good enough to say you loved. Believe me to be, my very dear good fellow, yours most sincerely, Sherlock Holmes."
Yours most sincerely, Sherlock Holmes. And so he perished, whom I shall ever regard as the best and wisest man that I have ever known.
The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, based on the original stories of the late Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, dramatized anew by John Keir Cross, stars Sir John Gielgud as Sherlock Holmes, Sir Ralph Richardson as Dr. Watson, and today, Orson Welles as Professor Moriarty. Produced by Harry Allen Towers. ¶¶
That was The Final Problem from The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes here on the Mysterious Old Radio Listening Society podcast. Once again, I'm Eric.
I'm Tim.
And I'm Joshua.
Ooh, this is going to be a rough one.
Oh, I knew you would hate this, which is why I waited till episode 250 because I thought it might soften your attack because you wouldn't want to ruin episode 250.
Celebrate. Let's make Eric hate something.
I don't hate it. I find it...
Can I just guess?
Yeah.
What's interesting to me about The Final Problem is it is incredibly famous as this mystery story. Mm-hmm. But it is a mystery story with no mystery. It is essentially all solution. Mm-hmm. It presents this meta solution to all the stories that came before it, and that is that Moriarty did it, right? And then there's this meta solution to Arthur Conan Doyle's problem of hating the character of Sherlock Holmes. Kill the poor bugger off. And outside of that context, if you come to it cold, like Eric probably did, it is just... British people talking for 30 minutes to some extent.
You're very close. It's bland and doesn't do much. But here's the deal. I have listened to The Final Problem. There are a couple different versions out there on radio. So one of the issues I have is I know this story way too well and I know where it's going. So as you brought this to the table, I was hoping with Gielgud, Orson Welles, something... that it would have some kind of, and I don't know what, but something where I go, oh, interesting take on that story, right? Interesting somehow, I don't know. And it was, yep, that's that story again. And I don't think the production is bad. I don't think that the acting is bad. I don't find anything horribly, it's just kind of, yeah, I knew that was coming and that was it. And none of the actors with their names brought anything to it that I found, oh, well, there you go. That's why you get top name actors. I just, yeah, it's fine. And here's the other thing. I love Basil Rathbone so much that I am such a jackass when I listen to anybody else.
That's fair.
I get so like, no, you're fine. But also, it's hard to do the waterfall fight, isn't it? And they did an interesting thing where they just didn't really do it at all.
Well, the story doesn't show it at all. It follows Watson because he narrates it.
Right,
he follows the fake emergency back to the hotel, realizes it's a trick, rushes back, and then uses Holmes' detective skills to see the footprints and Holmes' walking stick and goes, oh, no, and then finds the letter and reads the letter, and that's the end of the story.
He did.
I think the new adventures... you hear a fist fight for a while and then they grapple and then they fall. I may be making this up, but I think you actually hear,
Polly, I will not recover from this.
Arthur Conan Doyle hates me.
Ow, ow, stop it. Ow, knock it off.
I'm still alive.
You've read it, of course, and I haven't. When he confronts him in his study, and they have that discussion about the guns and all that. That whole conversation is ridiculous and fun. It's so one-upsmanship. It's crazy
it is
funny.
That.
It's like a parody of that.
Well, because I think it's one of the earliest versions of that.
Right.
Consciously civilized, insulting banter back and forth between two dignified enemies. But I think it has been parodied so much that this now feels like parody. Also, they added things for this adaptation, which makes sense because you get Orson Welles to play Moriarty. So you obviously want to expand those scenes. Moriarty is in two pages of the original short story. So the one thing they add that I absolutely love is the marksmanship competition. Yes. That is not in the original story. And that line, and I think the way Gielgud delivers it when he says, oh, your bullet mark is perhaps a shade smaller than my own. And by bullet mark, I mean penis. It is so obvious what they're talking about there.
I just got that.
And Tim, what do you say?
Oh, I mean, it's 100% both of everything Eric said is I agree with. Of like, yeah, this is a mystery that has no mystery, and the solution is I have evidence and I put you people in jail. Hmm? Like, I would like to know what that evidence was. How did you get that evidence? What is the actual story that is being told to me in a very abstract way? I'd be fascinated to know that. I acknowledge that that was not the point of this story. We're just supposed to, like, you just trust me. Holmes is a great detective, and Moriarty is a diabolical villain. He's brilliant. We won't tell you how, but just know that they're really smart. Then the tete-a-tete between the two is super fun. That's really the enjoyable part. And yes, it has the air of a cliche because it became a cliche, but this is not the cliche.
In many ways, this is the final chapter of this two-novel, 24-story arc that Conan Doyle has done, and it wasn't planned out at all. It was, I'm tired of this character.
It certainly comes off that way. Yeah. Like, he's like, I just want to wrap this up. Because as Tim's saying, there's a lot of fun detail we could have gotten in that final problem story.
And the power, to me, of the final problem is not that Holmes sacrifices his life, but that he sacrifices his friendship with Watson. The final moments when Watson realizes that Holmes has decided that Moriarty is so evil that he is worth ending his own life to get rid of, and this realization that he no longer has this friend is what makes Sherlock Holmes fans love this story. It's where the power is. And it's definitely, from my point of view, where this adaptation falls down. Because I think Ralph Richardson gives a just strangely unemotional reading of that letter and that final beat. He almost says those things as if he's saying something like, and they all lived happily ever after. He has this really just, I know he's a Victorian man, but I think there has to be more emotion or weight given to that.
There's also the disconnect in that, in the narrating that Watson does in that last time in Switzerland, of that he sometimes falls into reverie, sometimes he's forlorn, these emotional swings that do not connect to the performance at all.
Exactly. Yeah. I really, unlike Eric, think Gielgud is fantastic and Orson Welles is too. The two of them together, and they are doing a very understated take on the characters, but particularly Welles, I think, comes off as more sinister and evil by taking it down a notch instead of taking it up. I could talk about it more. I'll put a pin in that, but I think those guys are great, but I think it's let down by Watson, Ralph Richardson.
And I do like the dynamic of Welles is so underplay, like so friendly, so casual, whatever. And then that little bit you get to hear of him missing the train.
Yeah.
Where like, oh, that's the rage machine.
Yes.
There's the rage machine. It goes back to what Tim was saying about some details would have been nice and helped give this thing some shape and make it a little more interesting than just leading to let's kill Sherlock Holmes off and be done with this. Is the idea of how did Moriarty, with all of that planning, find him? Or was all of that planning meant by Holmes to give the illusion that he was trying to escape Moriarty when in fact he was giving Moriarty all the information he needed to find him so that he would find him at the waterfall on purpose? Do you get what I'm getting at?
Yep.
I would like to have known, oh my God, Moriarty, you're really good. I did a lot of third cab and jumping up here and running to that. And we did all this stuff and you still found me. Wow. Or, aha, so you fell for my trap that you thought I was trying to avoid you and I knew you'd be here. The one thing that makes me think that it wasn't a trap laid for Moriarty, that he was, that Moriarty just found him, is that moment where he says, Watson, are you back already?
Yeah.
So what is the Holmes world take on that? What do you guys think?
I'm just an enthusiast of the stories. I don't know what other Sherlock Holmes fans think. My reading of the story is that Holmes has a plan A and a plan B. And plan A is to survive and put Moriarty and his gang behind bars. But he has a plan B. He even mentions it in his conversation with Moriarty when Moriarty says something to the effect of, if you destroy me, I'm going to destroy you. And Holmes responds with, well, that would be worth it then. So it's already in Holmes' mind, but I think it is his backup plan. And Holmes knows that the emergency at the hotel is false. So I think in that moment he knows, and he moves to plan B, that he's going to wait there and not try to escape anymore, and he's going to end this now. That's how I read it.
And my hope is, like, if we had gotten those details, if it was like, let me tell you, dear listener, reader, how this played out. If we'd gotten that, my hope would be that it would be, yes, it was all put into play to make Moriarty feel like he had tracked me down, but I'm tired of this and we're both going to die. Like, even the note to the hospital was planted by Holmes himself to get Watson out of there.
Yeah, and I think that's a more modern take on these type of detectives, because it is incredible and super intelligent as Holmes is, he's not presented in all the stories as completely infallible.
Yeah.
I think this idea of an omniscient master planning detective is a more modern idea.
In some ways, plot-wise, Moriarty's beaten, his empire's destroyed, the deadline has come and gone, evidence is that he's slipped through the police's fingers, that's all. But for Holmes, that's too much. That's a bridge too far. I have to beat you completely or I haven't beaten you at all.
Right.
And also because Moriarty is that dangerous. And the story, I do think, successfully sets him up, even though it's retroactive, like he's the mastermind behind all these other terrible goings on. But the fact that Holmes is willing to sacrifice his life is not just ego, but it's because Moriarty is that dangerous that he will just set up his criminal empire again. The fact that Mycroft got off his ass and disguised himself as a cabbie tells you that this is real life and death.
Cameo appearance with no lines and no face appearance.
Let me ask you a question from the novels. It is pointed out that after this, he is pressured to bring Holmes back and writes a story after this one that takes place before the final problem.
Not immediately. That's much later.
I know.
Because he writes The Hound of Baskervilles next.
Yeah.
And tells people, it's before Sherlock Holmes died. I'm not bringing him back. I'm just grabbing some quick cash.
But I'm talking about the
Valley of Fear.
The one with Moriarty.
Yeah.
There is a reference in Final Problem where he says Moriarty, I'm paraphrasing this. He says Moriarty, and Watson is like, who? And he goes, oh, that guy, we met him once. Is that to set up Valley of Fear?
I think there
is
a canonical error that Watson has no idea who he is. And then Valley of Fear, he, in theory, would know who he was, although he's never met him. Met him at all.
But doesn't he say in this, that guy?
And they change it. In the original short story, Watson's like, who? And that's the whole idea, that Moriarty is just unknown by everyone.
Even
he is
Watson.
That hidden figure behind everything, pulling the...
So for this adaptation, they added the Watson remembering Moriarty from a moment in the past.
And because Watson is the listener identification character, so everybody in 1955 just knows that Moriarty is Sherlock Holmes' arch foe. So of course, Watson should know too.
Right.
Because even people who have never read Sherlock Holmes know this to be a fact.
I was just hoping it was actually in the short story, because that would be the thing you could grab onto and say, well, I did make mention, tiny little mention.
Sherlock Holmes is full of continuity errors. The Baker Street Irregulars, which was the biggest Sherlock Holmes fan club, are dedicated to finding all those errors and making them all work. Right? The whole shtick behind the Baker Street Irregulars is that they take the stories consciously. They're aware that they're not true, but they treat them as if they are, that Holmes and Watson are historical figures, and they do this sort of faux academic research to make it all work together and explain any incongruities. They give lectures, they have a newsletter, they give talks on how it all fits together.
We've done that in a few of our podcasts.
It's a little backfilling.
We've rewritten some stuff for Bishop.
A story like this, I cannot imagine what it would have been like to encounter the story having no idea who the character of Moriarty is or how it ends. It is just so well known.
I can tell you.
What?
I'm a time traveler. No, I became a Sherlock Holmes fan because I just happened to, I was maybe 11 or 12 to tune into PBS. Not happened to. I was a nerd. I tuned into PBS all the time.
What happened?
Oh, no. Mom, close the door. I'm listening to PBS. But Mystery was on, and I had heard of Sherlock Holmes, but I don't think I'd ever really seen a movie or read a book. And I'm like, oh, Sherlock Holmes. He's a really big, important detective. So I watched this Jeremy Brett adaptation from the 1980s of The Final Problem. And I'm watching it, and I'm watching it. Wow, exciting, and fighting on a waterfall. Wait, Sherlock Holmes fell off the waterfall?
Holmes, no!
What? He finally left a letter? He's really dead? Credits roll? What? And I was just aghast. And it's what made me go read the short stories. There's no internet to find out that he comes back 10 years later in a novel or another short story. I just thought Sherlock Holmes died. And keep in mind, this is like a year after Wrath of Khan. So I'm like, for Spock, then Sherlock Holmes? Is nobody safe? I had this existential crisis.
Oh, no. Oh, Sherlock. You've always been my friend.
I know Moriarty's the arch foe, but I just screamed, Khan!
I know how you feel. When they canceled the Planet of the Apes television show.
Oh.
And I cried so hard.
All right, I'm going to say one more super nerdy thing about Orson Welles' performance. I know we have noted many times in this podcast that it is much creepier to have someone whisper, I'm going to kill you, and scream, I'm going to kill you. So I think that's generally the performance style that Orson Welles went with as Moriarty. I think it's successful, but the nerdy part of me knows that in the original story, they describe Moriarty physically as having these reptilian features, like hooded eyes, and that his head oscillates back and forth in a strange reptilian way. So I wondered if that choice to do a sort of sibilant whisper was some sort of snake-like hiss. And I decided it was, and I thought, cool, Orson Welles, cool.
Well, you know, they hit those notes in the actual adaptation here, as well as, if I'm interpreting what they were saying correctly, that Moriarty was surprised that Sherlock Holmes didn't have a bigger forehead.
Yeah, he's clearly into phrenology. And that's straight from the original story.
And then Holmes is like, your forehead is much larger than I expected. And of course, but both of our foreheads are much smaller than Beethoven's.
Just so you know, once again, they're talking about their penis. Right, Joshua? Right?
Yes,
did I get that
exactly.
right?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
See?
And so when they say hooded eyelids, okay.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
We took us 250 episodes to say the word penis.
Now we're not going to stop. Penis, 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 penis.
The final penis. Cue the violin music.
That music was lovely, by the way.
It was.
Yeah. And
that's still my favorite part of all Sherlock Holmes.
This whole series and this episode in general, I find just incredibly soporific in the best way possible. I mean, that violin music, the really understated approach that Gielgud has to Holmes, train sounds, the rushing water of the falls.
Yeah.
I mean, this is great. You put this on, take like 3 grams of melatonin, and you are out like a light.
Do you think the implication was that Moriarty and Holmes were on the ledge talking to each other and the sound of the rushing water?
And they just fell asleep.
Hold on. Do you have to pee? Because, well, any other deep thoughts or should we vote on this?
Let's go ahead and vote.
I'll start it this week. It was fine. It's not a classic. Stands test time. Yeah, it's true to the stuff, and it got some good names, and they did really good, and the production value is good, and yay you.
Yeah, I think the series deserves a lot of credit for delivering very cozy, consistently faithful adaptations of the Sherlock Holmes stories. Like I said, as audio plays, they are quite sedate.
Right.
I can understand, Eric, and other listeners who might find a series like The New Adventures of Sherlock Holmes much more dynamic and interesting from an audio perspective, but these are just my warm, comfortable blanket for sure. Right. And I love The New Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, too. I'm not really going to complain about Sherlock Holmes radio shows. I love them all. But For me, what is a classic in this is the scene between Gielgud and Welles. They add material, but it's very true to what Doyle wrote, and it's fantastic. I love it. However, I think Richardson's lackluster, unemotional performance drags it down, because to me, that's the heart of the final problem. So I definitely cannot objectively give it classic status, but it's Sherlock Holmes, and no one can argue that anything Sherlock Holmes does not stand the test of time.
No.
Yeah. I agree with that. This is a story that, when put to radio, I think needed a little more adaptation than it got. There's some meat in the story that would have benefited from more attention than it got.
I mean, the original story is just Holmes has vague evidence. There's nothing to flesh out, so they would have to add to it.
Which we do with modern adaptations, television and otherwise, get a lot of information that is extrapolated or made up.
Like he had been in touch with the London police, so it would be interesting to know the moment when he finds out Moriarty escaped.
Yeah.
Like, that would be an interesting moment to see for Holmes, even if it doesn't have all the plot details. But yes, stands the test of time. High quality production. The cast is just that cliche of listening to the reading of the phone book, let alone do this classic stuff. Very, very good.
I mean, you know, they could have added a car chase scene, for example. Wouldn't have killed him.
Get to the waterfall.
That's our new catchphrase.
Get to the waterfall. Tim, tell him stuff.
Please go visit ghoulishlights.com. You'll find 250 episodes. There's a couple of episodes there was like a Christmas bonus episode and 148. We had 5 installments to it, so it's over 250 episodes technically at this point. More later in time, as Eric keeps pointing out, that this lasts forever. So if this is the year 3000, there's more than 250 episodes now.
Right.
There's, you can count episodes.
255. Yes. Guys, I really want to talk about slowing down.
You can vote on episodes and polls. Let us know what you think. You can leave comments. You can send us messages. You can link to our social media pages. And that was too big of an and, because there's two more things. And you can go to our Thread the Store, buy some swag, and you can go to our Patreon page.
Yes, go to patreon.com/themorals and support this podcast. You get all sorts of stuff, and I tell you about it every time. So I'm going to focus on one particular thing that I'm having a lot of fun doing, and that is Joshua's Mysterious Old Book Club. If you become a patron, you can join me and a bunch of other patrons who are nerds, the most excellent kind of nerds, discussing mysterious old books. So far, we've had a discussion of M.R. James, and we have had a really great discussion by the time this has been released. We haven't had it yet, but I'm sure it's going to be a great discussion about In a Lonely Place, a fantastic underread piece of literary noir. So become a patron. Read more. Give us more money.
Also, as an added for our Patreons, we've started the Take a Nap with Eric. Get in your favorite recliner, click the Zoom link, and we can watch each other sleep.
It was really cute until the watch each other sleep part. You just always take it one step too far.
Yeah, well. Hey, if you'd like to see us perform, we do adaptations of classic old radio shows live on stage and a lot of our own original work. The Mysterious Old Radio Listening Society Audio Theater performs monthly. If you'd like to find out where we're performing and see us performing, go to ghoulishdelights.com or mysteriousoldradiolisteningsociety.com, and there you'll see where we're performing this month and what we are performing. However, I will be honest, in this weirdness of the internet that lasts forever, here in February of 2022, we are actually not doing a show in February of 2022.
What?
It's our first month off in 6 years that we haven't done a show, but well-earned month off. But yeah, come and see us and buy a ticket in person or online. We'd love to have you around. What's coming up next?
Next, we will be listening to an episode of Gunsmoke entitled Never Pester Chester. Until then,
look out! Is that you, Watson? Back already?
Well, Moriarty,
Well, Sherlock Holmes, you see, I found you after all. Hand to hand?
Yes. Goodbye, Professor Moriarty.
Goodbye, Sherlock Holmes.